Hello, my name is Arnaud Delorme, and this is a series of video on robust statistics applied to EEG data. This is part one, which is an introduction to inferential statistics. In this presentation, there's a lot of statistics, obviously. I want to mention, though, that I'm not a statistician. My approach here is very practical and focuses on inferential statistics, which is about figuring out if an effect is robust and significant. So why do we do statistics, by the way? There are two key aspects to statistics. First, once you find that great feature in your EEG data, you want to know if it's reliable and reproducible. Statistics can tell you the likelihood that this effect occurs by chance. If you want to test if dogs can talk and you see a dog talking, then you do not need statistics. However, statistics is especially important for EEG, which is a very noisy signal, and effects can appear due to random fluctuation in that signal. The second important part is modeling your data. If you have an hypothesis that a specific treatment affects the EEG in a specific way, you can test that hypothesis with statistics and either accept or reject your model. You can also determine how well you want your model, or well your model fits the data. Also, once you have a model, you can make prediction on data that has not yet been acquired. So this is the outline of this lecture. First, we'll talk about parametric and non-parametric statistics, which means basic statistics, t-test, ANOVA, etc. Then I will talk about what we can do to improve that. I will then describe the bootstrap and permutation method, which consists in building surrogate distribution of values to perform inferential statistics. Also, in EEG, we perform large numbers of comparisons, usually one for each time sample or each time frequency point. So it is important to correct for all these statistical tests, something we call corrections for multiple comparisons. I will talk about different methods for correcting for multiple comparisons commonly used for EEG. Finally, we will talk about group-level statistical analysis of EEG data in EEGLAB. Before we start, I want to mention a few important take-home messages. First, look at your data and show your data. Looking at the raw data will give you a general sense of the quality of the data. Looking at your data from different angles and using different methods will ensure that whatever great discovery you've made is not a fluke. Second, a perfect universal statistical recipe does not exist. Depending on the question you're interested in, you might want to use different methods. There are workhorses, of course, that you use often, but sometimes you need to use special methods. For example, using circular statistics to look at different differences in phase of the EEG signal in the time frequency domain. Third, keep exploring. There are many great options, most of them available in free software and toolboxes. So how do we do inferential statistics and draw conclusions about our data? For example, say you want to compare the EEG of participants from group A to participants of group B.
Mr. Delorme.
Yes, me from the past.
This is super simple. You just put the data in the statistics software and then see if the p-value is below 0.05. There is no need for complex statistics.
Me from the past. If I did not know you better, I would probably recommend that you give up doing science for the sake of humankind. This view is shared by a lot of people, and one of the main reasons why we have reproducibility problems in science. So if I rephrase what you say, your null hypothesis can be that there is no difference in the EEG of your participants A and B. You perform EEG measurements and compare the actual difference of the EEG between A and B with your null distribution, in general based on parametric statistics. If the measurements lie in the tail of the null distribution, so the upper or lower area representing 5% of the total distribution area, then you can decide that it is significant. And yeah, you're done. Let's see why this simplistic approach is incomplete at best. First, we also need to consider the alternate hypothesis. The alternate hypothesis is that there is a difference between two conditions. There is also an error associated with incorrectly accepting the null hypothesis. So if we look at the table below me, if we reject the null hypothesis, and it is true, this is a type 1 error, so this is the standard alpha value we're all familiar with. And if we fail to reject the null hypothesis and it is false, so in other words, if we conclude that there is no difference between A and B, but in fact there is one, this is a type 2 error. One may argue that this error is not as important as the one that concludes that there is a difference when there is none. But if this error is too high, you will never be able to conclude there is an effect while in fact it is present. Most importantly, you should not conclude that there is no effect unless your type 2 error is low. You might have heard the quote, absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. A derived concept is statistical power, which is 1 minus the type 2 error. The higher the statistical power, the less likely you are to accept the null hypothesis when it is false. Finally, standard practice recommend reporting the exact p-value, and not only if it's above or below the 0.05 thresholds, which is a threshold which was arbitrarily set in the 1920s. To compute the exact p-value, you can simply assess the relative area in the tail of the distribution using your experimental value as a threshold. Also, you must report the effect size, which is an indication of how different the EEG between A and B is. So in case of two groups, it's simply the difference of the means of A and B divided by the pooled standard deviation. Understanding effect size is important. Their standard effect size, which with 0.2 representing a small effect size, 0.5 representing a medium effect size, and 0.8 representing a large effect size. Why does it matter? You can imagine that if you have a large number of participants, say 10,000, you might be able to observe significant effects for minute change in the EEG. These changes might be so small that they cannot be used for any practical purposes and are not even interesting. This is why it's very irritating to see in the news sometimes vitamin X taken daily increases longevity. And if you were to look at the fine print, you might be able to see that this study was done on 10,000 people and that longevity statistically only increases by 3 days. Really, who cares about such a small effect, which is anyway possibly confounded by other variables? From my perspective, this is close to fake news. So this is why it's very important to report the amplitude of the effect. The other advantage of considering effect size and statistical power is that it can help you to calculate your sample size. These days, it's difficult to get a grant accepted without at least a basic power calculation to justify your sample size. Once you know your desired alpha value, your desired statistical power, and expected effect size, you can use standard tools to calculate sample size. So here, for example, I just found this website where you enter the group 1 mean and standard deviation. So this could be your ERP amplitude, for example. Then, based on literature, you try to infer the minimum change you will want to be able to observe. So in this case, let's say 10% increase for your treatment group. You can also enter your maximum alpha value and minimum statistical power, and the software will return the minimum sample size. There are also functions in MATLAB in R to do that, and which I indicate here. This solution is not perfect because it uses parametric statistics assumption for your data, so the measure can be biased, but it's a good start. Note that for group analysis in neuroimaging studies, sample sizes usually range from 16 to 32 participants. So if you have less participants, your study might be underpowered. So we've done our due diligence, performed power calculation, and acquired some data, and now we're ready to analyze it. Why not use simple parametric statistics? Based only on the mean and standard deviation of the data, we can calculate t-values. Then we can compare our calculated t-values to the distribution of t-values under the null hypothesis and assess if our t-values lie in the tail and there is therefore significance. There are formulas for unpaired data, such as two groups of participants randomly sampled in the population. We also have a different formula for paired data, such as different conditions for the same participants. We can also calculate ANOVA based on the same principle when we have more than two groups of participants or more than two conditions. Except we'll now deal with F distribution instead of T distribution. it's important to note that these statistics assume that the data can be reasonably well fit to a Gaussian distribution. This is implicit when we use the formulas here, which assume that the mean and standard deviation are accurate descriptor of the data. Of course, if you use these statistics, you should also test if these assumptions is valid, and your statistical software will usually do that automatically. There are other types of statistics based on the type of data and hypothesis you may have. These are statistics to compare discrete values. For example, when you count the number of participants on which you observe an effect, or where when you consider yes/no answers to questionnaires. There are statistics for continuous data, which are typically the ones we use for EEG. There are also statistics for ranked data. These are usually used to compare ordered data, but can also be used on continuous values such as reaction time or even EEG. For each type of data, you have a different recipes if you want to compare groups of participants, conditions, or perform regression analysis, etc. So this is just a summary slide so you can pick the best standard statistics for your usage model. Another approach is to use surrogate statistics, and we'll talk about that in one of the future lectures. I also want to mention that for continuous measurements, the general linear model framework can encompass all study design. I've made a video on this topic and put a link in the description below. So I want to thank you for your attention, and I'll see you in the next video.